Welcome to Renee Marie Strokolov. Hang on one second. I just want to make that a little bit wider so that everybody can see me. And see, Damont is on the other line coming from Michigan. He's my co-host today, and his wife Dana, who is an inspiration to all of us, as well as Damont, are my special co-hosts today. I don't like to call them guests because we're more friends and really a co-host, and we're really here to share the same message for everybody, and we really wanted to bring it today. And we had an issue the other day, which we called Plan B, which was actually, I called the show Plan B, and all of a sudden we had to click to Plan B because we had technical difficulties, and Dana and Damon were really gracious enough to set another time aside to talk to us, and we're really blessed and honored. And welcome to Renee Marie Strokolov. This platform is just incredible that we could be coming into your lives and really touch your lives and really communicate with you over the internet. So we're really happy. We're really happy. And let me formally introduce one of my co-hosts today. And we decided to do them separately so that they could really have the platform to share their message. And maybe at the end we'll do just a little together when we say our closing prayer, because we always like to pray about what we're doing and where we're going. And maybe I'll ask Damont to just say a few words before we begin. But I really want to introduce a really wonderful, close friend. I can call him and Damont now, Dana now. And really, really special person. Really a wonderful person. This is Damont. Hi, Damont.
Hello, everyone. How's it going today?
We're good. We're good. Facebook is live. We're okay on okay. Facebook. Can everybody hear us out there? Give us a like if you can hear us, please, so that we know that we're coming in loud and clear. So we are. We are. We are. So, Damont, can you believe the way that things evolved? And, the name of the show was Plan B, and all of a sudden we had to go to Plan B. What did you think?
I think when life is about Plan B all the time. You know, what are you going to do on your Plan B? You know, sometimes, you know, that Plan A doesn't work the way it does. So, what you have other options. You have, you know, when we're playing football, we play option football. You know, we can either throw the football or we can run the football. So, you know, you got to learn how to use these options properly. And like I said, using that Plan B is so important. You use that Plan B at all times.
Well, Plan B is kind of like another option, you know. In life, you know, I know me, I have focused, and I used to like be so zeroed in on what it is that I want and desired that I never saw God saying, hello, hello, no, that's not what I want you to do. No, over here, Renee, over here. And I never listened until he hit me on the head with a bat. And then 13 years later, he made me have a stroke. And that's when I finally realized that you need to be open and follow your guidance and really be open to change. And changes, and I was telling someone the other day that really is the only guarantee in life is that there's going to be change.
Yeah. And, you know, even like we're talking about change, and changes that you have to change every day. You know, life is about changing, you know, like change thinking, change actions and change expectations in your life, but you have to learn how to adapt to those changes. You know, that's just like with us suffering and these setbacks in our life. However, yes, we can be either a negative or positive force those setbacks or those changes in our lives. So we have to learn how to adapt to those changes at all times.
Dana and I know a mindset, how we have to have a different mindset. Especially after suffering a stroke or any illness, is not to really take it on and own it as ours, because we're really just going through it. We're experiencing it for a specific reason. And so talk to me about your mindset and how you had to disconnect from your stroke. Although I will tell you that you and I and Dana and other American Stroke Associations and other victims really are become advocates. So being an advocate is not the same thing as distancing. What am I trying to say?
Disconnecting.
That's perfect terminology. Disconnecting from the occurrence that happened, suffering a major stroke. Because you know what? That's only for one split second, right? So tell me about that.
Well, it's so difficult. You know, it's not just one little facet of what we have to deal with on a daily basis. You know, I always say it's not like putting a bandaid on our head and we're going to be okay in a couple of months or years or anything. These are lifelong transitions in our lives. You know, people have to really understand how to adapt to these changes and making the best of it. Either we can be positive or negative through any type of situations in our lives. You know, we have to adapt to it and change with it. And it's either like you're gonna be positive or negative in life. And I know that 87% of people are negative. So you have to be that 13% to say, okay, this has happened to me in my life. What am I going to do about it? Either I'm going to be pitiful or powerful.
Yeah.
You know, so, you know, and just like we're talking about options, you know, I can sit here, you know, it's been 22 years, Renee, and it'd be 23 in August.
Your daughter's putting something in the camera. Hi. Trinity.
Okay, Trinity, grab the bottle.
Trinity, let us see you since you saw your I'm sorry. I didn't want anybody to think we were... Hi, that's Trinity. That's Jamal and Dana's daughter. Hi, Trinity.
Hello.
We just wanted them to know Demont wasn't. There was little things coming into your. So, I'm sorry. Anyway, so back to our story.
Okay, so we were talking about just being positive or negative.
Right.
I hope I remember what I was saying. So you know, I had to do that 13% to say I want to. Overcome this situation. You know, what really motivated me is, you know, I have a great support system with me.
That's
you know,
so important.
My mother. You know, my mother was there, you know, and she never gave up on me. You know, I like I said, I had my parents, I had my friends, you know, but however, at the end of the day, I had to just put it in God's hands and let Him get me through this situation. You know, I was sitting here trying to do everything on my own. And it wasn't until I accepted Christ in my life, I'm like, God made me go through this type of situation. You know,
But can I ask you something? Would you mind if I ask you something?
Yes.
Because it's almost a catch-22 when you suffer a stroke, specifically because a stroke is a brain attack, right?
Absolutely.
And we need to know that we need to trust in God and that we need to just relax and let things evolve and we need to trust in other people. But the fact that our brains are scrambled and there's no boundaries anymore, there's no like, and I always use the phrase like defragment your brain like a computer. You know, where sometimes you have to put on defragment and say, okay, this belongs here and this belongs there. And this belongs. But our brains, after a stroke, some survivors, I should say, I don't like to use the word victims, some survivors are more affected by the scrambling and some aren't. But at that particular moment, we are disheveled. And it's almost like a piece of glass falling on the ground, and now you got to pick it all up. So, how severe was your brain, and how long did it take you to come back from that?
When we were talking about the broken pieces, it was like my whole life was shattered. And once that happened, and it just took that long period of time putting things back in order. You know, I would call my stroke the stroke with the complications. I was, like I said, with me being in the coma for 2 weeks, I have cognitive difficulties. However, I have to understand how, like I said, how to adapt to those changes.
Wow.
You know, but just to adapt, you know, even like if people see me, they think, well, nothing's wrong with me, not happening to me. But the mental and the emotional side that I deal with on a daily basis that some people are not even talking about. You know, we can go to physical therapy, occupational therapy, and speech therapy, but we have to have that mental therapy,
That's right. You know,
to understand, like, what happened to me? Why did this cause, what caused this, and how can I, like you said, adapt to this change?
And how to understand that, you know, to love yourself enough to accept the changes. And to have to go through the changes, you have to be in plan B. Life is not about plan A, it's about plan B, you know, because you have to adapt to that.
And you were talking about adaption, even just thinking about all the stuff that we have to go through on a daily basis, you know, it's difficult. It's not an easy task, you know. You might can say, look at Renee and look at me and you have to understand, well, we have to work 10 times harder than anyone else. You know, we get tired quickly. It just takes more effort of anything we're doing.
But we're aware of the effort as well.
Yeah.
We're aware that to stay in the mainstream and to stay with everybody else, we need to be that way.
Absolutely. And it just really, turn it a little bit. Okay.
That's okay.
Yeah. So, see, and then, like I said, I have these mental, you know, especially when I'm going through so much, and it's sometimes I have to learn how to slow down and think about what we're just discussing.
Yeah.
You know?
And slow down to in my world, sometimes I'm so fast and just want to get things done. And this is something that I just became aware of, that I want to get things done because I know that life is so fragile. And that every single moment in life could be your last moment. And we have no control over what is our last moment. So do we really want to waste it, or do we want to value it and really do everything we can?
And you know, this is why I can't just sit and just be idle any longer. You know, either I have to look at what God saved me for a reason and to help other people. You know, because I know, just like I'm still crying out for help. I'm so blessed to meet you and have you in my life to say, okay, he understands or she understands what I go through. And this is what I'm talking about with Survivor Network, so we can start addressing issues with the extra survivor. You know, we live this every day of how to learn, how to. Even like putting on our socks is difficult. You know, some people think about the simplest tasks of things in life, but they don't really understand this until it happens to them.
No, they don't.
You know, yeah. So just like with me, I had to understand the new me. You know, and look at it, like I'm not the same 23-year-old guy that just graduated from Morehouse and everything. I have a different approach of life now. You know, like, God has blessed me with a wife, with a child, with Trinity and stuff now. And I had to really look at what he's doing in my life right now.
Right.
And address Trinity, know that you have to just address every issue right now and just deal with it. You know, either you're going to be, I would say I was going to be pitiful, powerful on some things, you know.
Right.
But however, you know, we have to look at everything onto a whole different perspective. Yeah.
I remember, you know, because after my stroke, I really got into empowerment as well, and really got into reading books, and actually when I'm traveling to PA now, because I'm freelancing in PA, I actually listen to Dale Carnegie and how to, right, so, you know, if the mind is so important, but although we know that now because we're aware of that, you know, I'm always thinking to myself, you know, those victims, those not victims, but those survivors that are laying in the bed. Because I remember going to the hospital and seeing a patient right after they suffered a stroke and looking at them and like saying to them, you will survive. Look at me. I'm okay. And not only is that empowering to the person that's laying in the bed, but the families around. The families around have tears coming down their eyes because, like, oh my God, there is hope. There is hope.
Right. And you know, and that's why I wanted to do something, you know, with, when I started volunteering with American Heart. And, you know, we think about the families and the victims or the individuals who have to go through these situations. They're afraid. They don't know what to deal with, what's going to happen. You know, so. And how long is it going to take? You know, it, like I said, it's been 22 years for me. And it wasn't easy. And I'm still a work in progress.
I know. Me too.
Yeah.
I mean, mine happened over 25 years ago.
Okay.
And every day I get more aware and develop and in tune. But although I will tell you, DeMont, that even though we are from the stroke world, every single person is developing and becoming aware in their lives.
Absolutely.
It's different ways that God tries to get your attention and really your path. So, you know, the only reason I say that is because some people that are looking at us would separate us from other people, and we're all one. We're all one. We all have different ways to get to the same point, and that's really love and to have relationships in our lives.
Yeah. And, you know, having those strong and powerful relationships, that's meaningful relationships, you know, even like I said, having support systems in place. You know, we maybe don't have all the same support systems like we used to, but however, this, like I said, this is a platform now that we can start reaching out for other people and say, hey, I feel the same way. You know, I know I'm not the only one that feel like, okay, certain days I feel good, some days I don't, you know, and like I said, just having that support system, like with my wife, you know, where, you know, if I had, if I wouldn't have the opportunity to have her help me with certain situations, where would I be here?
That's right.
You know, yes, I have family and stuff, but, you know, just the mental and emotional of it, you know, it's really difficult, you know, so I don't have to really think and stress about things. The stress alone, or trying to survive being a survivor, you know, that's the hardest thing. Oh, how I'm going to take care of financial situations. You know, this is one of my problems, or one of my mother's biggest fears. How will, if something happened to her, would my be able to maintain and survive on his own? You know, because, you know, when we were going through the rehab process, I had counselors tell me, DeMont, you have the mind of a 2-year-old, nothing I can do for DeMont. You know? So, you know, I'm just...
And doesn't that astound you that somebody who is the medical field, although they may have some more knowledge than we do in that particular area, but to crush someone's hope, because miracles happen through hope.
Absolutely.
Miracle. You can't have a miracle unless you have hope.
Absolutely.
So if they're going to crush it, then you're going to stay down there.
Yeah. And this is what I'm talking about. 87% of people are negative. You know, you have to be that 13% to say, okay. And then you have to really dig down in yourself and say who you are and whose you are. You know, once you get to that point, you're like, oh, wow. So... And this is what, you know, with me, I had a second chance of life. I would like to do it properly. You know, because some people would not have the opportunity to wake up tomorrow. And like you said, just having just be able to say, okay, I'm going to help somebody else. And that's what life is about. When you life, you have to seize it, make it amazing, and have adventures with it, you know. But you have to look at it and say, well, my whole purpose is to help people, you know. And it's not just the all about me. It's not about the mind. It's not about, you know, it's about what God's putting in me and to stretch air with the world, you know. And that's where people have to look at life now, you know, because I'm looking at, like, on the reality shows and everything, everybody's so consumed of all the stuff, just don't even make any difference of life. Yeah. So you have to, what difference is all that stuff, you know? I don't need a Bentley. I don't need, you know, a Range Rover and all. I need, you know, like, when I was sitting in that hospital for 4 months, watching seasons change, I learned how to appreciate life on a whole different perspective that some people would not understand.
Yeah.
You know?
So, but the truth is that the gift is with you is that you are aware. You didn't fall back into, you know, once you became mainstream again, you didn't go back to being the way that you used to be. You were aware that it's about other people now. It's about doing the right thing.
Right. And it's not, like I said, doing it with corporate America, trying to be, come on, baby. You know, just being in corporate America alone, you know, in the stresses of life. You know, I see so many people, well, I'm trying to chase the dollar. You know, I need a salary of $100,000. And, you know, it's not about that. Mm-hmm. You know, I look at so many things, like the blessings of waking up, going outside, and just having a home, you know, that I can sleep peacefully.
Yeah.
You know, I have food in the refrigerator, yeah. And you know, some people don't have that opportunity. Yeah. And you know, but see, we have to, as individuals, we have to get to the point: how can I help this individual? You know, that's why I would love for people, if they need somebody to call and talk to, you know, because I know it's a survivor out here. Like, I don't have no one to talk to.
Yeah.
I don't, I don't have any friends.
Yeah. Because
when you suffer a stroke or something, you know, your friends, you know, you most, like, probably like 90% of them not gonna be here for you.
Well, they're not there because they're so busy in life. They don't understand it yet. They don't get it. They haven't gotten that aha moment to wake up and understand that life is about people and about relationships. And in my life, as hard as it is, DeMont, and I know it's hard, I always try to do the right thing. And the right thing is the hard thing all the time. It's the hard thing all the time. You know, it's choices in life which you have to make. And we were blessed to have a surrounding of family and friends and around us to help us make those right choices, you know, to guide us to make those right choices, you know, because with our brains shambled a long, long time ago, you know, it really touches me to think about those that their brain scrambled. I mean, even when someone who has Down syndrome or someone that, you know, has suffered a stroke or someone that has a brain injury, you know, a severe brain injury, when they come to me and look at me and they just talk through their eyes, DeMont, they just talk through their eyes and they tell us so much truth in what they're saying because they don't know how to be unfaithful and be untrue.
Right. It's one of those things, Renee, where, you know, the reality of life now is those things that we have to walk through and grow through as individuals, you know, but this is what life is about, you know, like I said, adapting. I have to look at other individuals now, you know, instead of just thinking about myself. Because, you know, with me, I try to help everybody, you know. because somebody helped me.
Right.
You know, and you have to get it, you have to pay it forward or help other individuals, because if you can't help other individuals, what are you here for?
Yeah.
You know, and that's like with me working with American Heart. You know, they have the passion to help other people. You know, and I know working, you know, like to be on the board members and being a board member there, it motivates me so I can be that person to say, this is what stroke survivors need.
Right.
You know.
So tell us.
Yeah.
Well, now that you're on the American Stroke Association topic, I heard from a little bird that, and her name is Dana, your wife, that on December 6th, you will be receiving an honorary award from the American Stroke Association. So, congratulations. You definitely deserve it, you know, as well as everybody else that works hard.
Yeah.
But tell us a little bit about it. What was the difference? Do you know what their mindset was?
The mindset, you know, it's a volunteer award. It's just what I'm trying to do in the community. You know, it's helping other people. You know, we go to stroke groups and just being a part of a stroke group or meeting individuals, you know, if you have to go to different organizations and just interact with other stroke survivors, you know, and this is why we did the documentary also, and we used it as a tool to say, I can do it, you know, that's not the name of the documentary, I know I can. So just to show people, well, DeMont did it, and I can do it also. And this is why I'm saying, if you can't beat them, you have to join them. So, you know, I started, you know, like I said, as just being a volunteer, and they gave me the opportunity to sit on the board. And I've been on the board for over 2 years now.
Wow.
And that was just, like I said, a blessing for me, because they know how important to be able to build healthy communities, you know. Where I was at an event, I believe it was Tuesday. It was at Second Ebenezer Church in Detroit. They're doing blood pressure checks in the community. You know, people need to check their blood pressure and everything. You know, so it's important to do that instead of just sitting on the couch, because people don't understand how blood pressure plays a major role in, you know, in stroke and any type of heart disease issues like we have right now. You know, yes, I was not aware of my blood pressure when I was 23. You know, I was in college, you know. When you're in college, you're eating ramen noodles, trying to survive, french fries, potato chips, everything. So, you know, this is the opportunity to have a better, healthy choices also in your diets.
Right.
You know, just like with me, I'm probably, when I was 20 years old, 20, 21 or whatever, I was probably 160, 170 pounds or something like that. But however, I had those bad habits when I was in college, you know, and this is what, you know, people have to understand, you know, if you're doing something, it's going to affect you somehow, some way, you know. It had to really learn how to take those negatives and take them to a positive.
Yeah.
You know, so once we did that, and just helping people in the community, and what people need, you know, like healthy choices of foods availabilities, you know, it helps. You know, we can't have all the fast foods, and you know, I sit there and I'm very observant of just watching people, you know, and what people, you know, most people are overweight, you know, they're not active, you know. You can be active just like with me. I don't go to the gym pushing up 200-300 pounds stuff.
Right.
I do exercise with me, Renee, just by washing some, you know, putting the dishes up, moving, you know, stretching, you know, just making sure that you can continue moving on a daily basis.
Right, and that's what it's about. It is about keep moving. Don't get stuck. Because even energetically and spiritually, you have to keep your life going. You have to keep driving down that road. It's like you don't want to get pulled over to the side and you're stuck without gas and you have a flat tire. You're not going to do anything about it. What are you going to do? You're going to sit there and rock? No, you're going to figure out something to do to solve your problem and to move on. So once again, plan B.
Yeah, and like I said, the preventive maintenance on yourself.
Right.
You know, like I said, it starts by mentally, you know, working on yourself. Like, I got to do something now. Or I got to, you know, can at least help eat a little bit better, you know. So we have to look at it, what we can do, you know, that can really change.
And the truth is that sometimes our minds play a big role a bigger role than we imagine, because we think about something and we create issues in our own brains that, you know, and I've learned once again at this point in my life that, you know what, just face it, whatever it is, if you face it head on, even with the stroke, even with the, you know, the challenges, no matter what it is, if you face it head on, it'll be easier than sitting back and thinking about it and making yourself so crazy about that, that it's not healthy for you. And that's why, once again, we keep going back to having our family and friends around us so that they can keep us on track when we, as stroke survivors, that our brain is scrambled, they could say, no, it's okay. You do this. You keep doing this. You keep trying that. You'll be fine. You'll be fine. And that really is important.
Right. And with me also, Renee, I allowed fear somehow to hold me back on some things. This is what I'm saying with me, with the Toastmasters now.
That was next on my list.
I was so fearful, like we're doing, you know, getting back into speaking, you know, again. You know, my wife helped me out so many things. Let's work on presenting, you know, with your speaking, you know, grammar. And, you know, it's at first I was like, well, it's criticism, but it's good criticism.
Yeah.
You know, because she wants to be the best for me, you know, and
She wants to see you develop.
Yeah. You know, she wants me to grow. And, you know, and that's why I love my wife, because she's such a caring individual and wants the best for me.
Yeah.
You know, and I just know that God just blessed me with her in my life, you know, that's just been that part of my life that I didn't know where I was going to go. Then God said, okay, I'm gonna give you a helpmate, you know, and once, you know, that changed my life completely, you know, and this is a complete blessing for me. With Dana and Trinity in my life, and it's just, you can just see the difference of me. You know, I have joy in my life again. You know, like I said, I just lost my mother 5 years ago, and it was just, I was feeling kind of hopeless, like, what can I do, you know? But however, I just had to really trust in him, you know, and once I just gave it to him and just let go, let God, you know, do his thing. And that's when he just started showing, opening doors. And it's just like, wow.
Yeah.
So it's just the most amazing thing in my life, you know, like I said, what God is doing, you know. He can do it.
He can. I always say, I got to get out of my own way.
Yeah. That's exactly what I was doing also, you know.
He's there.
Beating myself up and everything. And you know, they was like, just stop beating yourself up sometimes, you know. You're good. You do well, you know. So once we got to that point in my life, I was like, I can relax.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, I didn't have to stress no longer.
Yeah,
you
yeah.
You know, because that stress will kill you.
You know, stress is one of the main causes of illnesses. You know,
absolutely.
It just kind of, it comes out in different ways in different people, but it really is one of the main ways. And that's why faith is so important in our lives. And we are not one to tell people what faith they are, as long as they are a good person and they believe in God and or believe in themselves or higher powers or whatever they want to believe in. But when things happen, you have to have something to hold on to. And in our world, it's God, but you know, or a friend, or a family, or whatever. But you have to be connected in life because it's too hard. It's too hard. Now you started another support group at the Mount,
yes.
The Mount Olive.
Yes. You know, I always wanted to run my own group. You know, I attended a couple of local stroke groups. That are awesome groups, you know, First Step Stroke Group and Farms and Hills. Excellent group, you know, they meet once a week at the Cossack Center in Farms and Hills, Michigan. Then you have a couple other local stroke groups, also with Beaumont Hospital. But one thing I learned about support groups is just, you know, most of them are once a month, you know. However, as a survivor, we need constant interaction. You know, once a week is enough, but we need our own groups, you know, that's ran by survivors.
Right.
You know, and even like I said, the help for other caregivers also, that needs a break once in a while, you know, just to get that support system. And that's like, you know, at peace with my wife, you know, she always, here to help other people. And you know,
right.
As her being a pastor, she knows how to help other people.
Right. Well,
you know,
I'm sorry, but what's coming to me is, because I've been to support groups as well, and they're wonderful, you're correct.
Yes.
But knowing what we need to strive, we need to have, each individual is different, and we
mm-hmm.
need to have goals, like to better ourselves. Okay, you know,
yes.
You're here, okay, I want you to get here. You know,
right.
And what do you need to get there? You need to learn 10 more words? Then
mm-hmm.
What words are you going to say? What words are you going to learn? And you give it to them because each individual is different and they need
yes.
to have the support. You need to,
yes.
And that was one thing that when I was an ambassador one time, they said to
mm-hmm.
me, you know, we as the profession, we can't say to them, you have to do it yourself.
Mm-hmm.
You, because that's the truth. Nobody can teach us to walk again. Nobody can teach us to talk again. Nobody
mm-hmm.
can. We have to be motivated ourselves. So you
right.
need somebody to inspire them to do that. So that is why, you know, the professions really like the fact that I was there, because I could
mm-hmm.
say to them, you know, I could talk about my own story, you
right.
know, and how we had to do it ourselves and we had to learn and we had to push ourselves. And although you and I are focused and we're determined,
mm-hmm.
some people who are stroke survivors don't have that in their back pocket, and they
yes.
need somebody to help them get
mm-hmm.
there.
It is so important, you know. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay. It's so important. It was coming in now. It is so important to have that support system, you know. But we have to look at what tools or that we can work on, you
yes.
know. I was thinking about when we were just sitting there talking, when I had to learn how to walk again, you know. Yes, I went to physical therapy, outpatient therapy, but I remember myself walking down the hallway with, you know, just walking down the hall.
Yeah.
You know, because
yeah.
you say that determination, but you have to have it in you to say, okay, I'm going to walk again.
Yes. Yes.
Or I'm going to...
Or not only I will walk again, I can walk again.
Yeah, I can walk again.
I can
you know?
Walk again.
Yeah. Because, you know, I looked at it because I went from a wheelchair to a walker to a cane to nothing at all. You know, and when you set goals of what you want to do and dedicate it and, you know, let you, you know, and see what you want.
Yes. Yeah.
You know, because what I was saying about when my counselor said nothing we can do for the money.
My curtain fell.
Okay.
Plan B.
Okay. You okay?
Yeah, I'm fine. Let it go.
Okay. All right. So this is once I had to do it on my own, and I'm so blessed that I had to go through these types of situations, you know, and this is where I had to look at, like, can I use this to help other people, or to share my story, or, because I know some people who's probably in a wheelchair, they can't move right now.
Nope.
You know, so, like, what can I do to say, okay, what's that next step to take that wheelchair to a walker? You know, even like with insurance and stuff. I haven't went back to rehab on my own because basically I have the tools of what I need to do for rehab. So, you know, you get your little workout packet and your little basic exercises and stuff. So they're going to tell you to do the same thing, but you have to keep on doing it,
right.
You know.
And that's really one of my visions is to create an ongoing recovery center after your insurance has run out, because that's what my foundation is about, supporting those when their insurance has run out, because... You know, although I know it's all political, and I know it's all documentation, and I know it's all about money, and, you know, and I understand it, because I'm a businesswoman as well, I understand it. But on the flip side, we as stroke survivors, and all everyone needs ongoing health care, and how we need to get that.
You know, think about that, you know, because when I was trying to get help, you know, some of the counselors and stuff, it's all our budgets. You know, I understand about budgets.
Yeah, me too.
And everything, you know, but at the end of the day, how are you going to help me? You know, mind you, I wanted to be able to get back into the workforce, you know. I had to basically do it my own, you know, find my own job. You know, I was blessed to meet, I had an individual that I met, his name was Larry Lyman. He gave me a job as a job coach and job developer for helping other people, you know, that's had some traumatic brain injuries and stuff, and it taught me how to be compassionate of people. So when he was like, come on, I think you would do excellent as a job coach or job developer.
Right.
You know, so he really, you know, gave me that opportunity. Say, okay, you can take that and use that skill set to be able to help other people, because he saw the passion.
Yes.
You know, so that really helped me. You know, and I'm very fortunate, very blessed to meet Larry. He's a great guy. You know, and when you have good people like that in your life that really cares, you know, instead of saying, well, nothing we can do for you, you know, this guy, he said, well, I see something in you, you know, and once, you know, an individual starts seeing something in you to say, okay, I want to help this person, you know, and it really helped me to take me to the next level, because my next step in life was, you know, after work in progress, I was able to secure employment with Goodwill Industries of Detroit, you know, then that's when I really, you know, working there, you know, working with people with mental illnesses and stuff, it helped these individuals, you know, that, well, I can sit there and tell them, well, I have a disability also, you know, but we can't use that to say, well, we can't live, we gotta keep moving, in life, you know, or we can't use that label that I'm a stroke survivor. So I had to learn how to change that.
Yes.
So instead of I'm a stroke survivor, I use my label saying I was an individual who overcame a stroke.
Yes, absolutely. And you know, the funny thing is when I apply for jobs or somebody asks me if I have any disablements and I say no, because in my mind, me looking at me, I'm fine. I'm fine. There's not one thing in my life I cannot do that I want to do. If we set our mind to it, now listen, I may not be able to hit a home run anymore, but I could still hit the ball, and I could still throw the ball, and I could still play. You know, so, yeah. And we will probably have more determination and excitement and live to play the game as equal to anybody else, to anybody else.
And, you know, I was a ball player also, you know. And playing baseball really helped me out so much, you know. And being an like you said, I can't probably swing like I used to or run like I used to, but I think I'm even better now because I'm more in tune with me, who I am, you know, and that really, 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 really kind of, how can I say this? I really found who I am.
Yes, me too. And we grow to like ourselves and respect ourselves, and it's okay with all our flaws.
Yes,
because we all have flaws, you know. even these beautiful models, you know, some of them, you know, complain about their legs are too long or their hips are, you know, like, you know, we all have flaws, you know. It's funny, but I just went to a speaking engagement at a church, St. Paul's in Allendale. I forget who was talking, but his concept was, do you really see me? Do you really see me? And that's so true, because through this process of going for jobs and really when you're in search of your next phase in your life, you're developing and you're learning so much about what you want to do and how you are. And that's one of the things I coach in my life coaching classes, Awaken Your Practice. And it's very interesting, like, do you really see me? Are you just looking at me as another number? Or are you looking in my eyes and you really listening to what I'm saying to you?
And most people it's not really, like I said, they're looking at you as a number.
Yeah.
Or they're never really looking at who you are as an individual. You know, and this is, people want individuals to listen to you.
Yes.
Or to help you. You know, I'm talking like with Larry Lyman. He helped me.
Right.
You know, like my friend Juan Burr, who produced I Know I Can, he helped me with that image. You know, and, you know, these type of situations, once a person that actually helped and really care about you, instead of just looking at you, like you said, as just a number, or a profit and growth situation, it really, instead of building that individual up, instead of bringing them down or holding them down, say, I'm going to just hold you to myself, you know, and instead of letting the individual fly or eat like an eagle. You know, spread your wings, you know.
Right, because they're thinking about themselves. They're thinking about their profitability and what they can do for themselves. When even in the Dale Carnegie book that I'm listening to, he talks about praising other people, lifting other people up. Because when you lift other people up, you will be successful yourself. You will be successful yourself.
You know, I love audiobooks. You know, we're talking about audiobooks now. You know, I know with me, reading a full novel or book is kind of difficult for me now.
Right.
So, you know, this is what some stroke survivors have to learn. You know, because sometimes when I was starting to read again, it's like the words was running together in the page.
Right.
You know, so this is, you know, I was, you know, when I was telling about like Valerie's book, being an audio, that's an audio book. See, you have those resources, not resources, they're resources, other strokes about it, so you can use that to say, okay, I have to adapt to learning how to read again.
Right.
You know, or listening to comprehend it. Because this one, when Valerie, I love her book because it's read as a perspective as a survivor.
Yes, and she speaks, you know, her truth. Yeah. She speaks, yes, her truth because, yeah, she sees it. And I love Valerie because Valerie, yeah, has a lot of panache. Valerie, yeah, has a lot of passion for life,
yes,
and nothing's going to stop her. You know, she's being an attorney, so,
yes,
you know, attorneys know how to state their case, you,
yes,
know? So,
yeah,
you know, from her perspective, she knows what is right and what is wrong,
right,
and she knows how to make you listen to her.
Yes.
She's got that dynamic about her.
Yeah.
You know?
And, you know, that's why I try to live, I learn from my wife. She has so many different skill sets where if I
she
can
does.
Just sit there and just listen to her, so
yes.
And I'm like, well, she is just like a book full of knowledge, you know, it helps me with so many things. And once, like I say, getting those tools and putting them in place for you, you know, it's so, will make, you know, as survivors, it make our lives a little bit easier.
Yes, yes.
You know, we don't have to make it, we don't have to reinvent the wheel again.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, we just have to polish some things up in our lives. You know, like I said, we scrambled a little bit, but however, we still here.
Yes.
You know, we probably still can't hit a home run and run all the bases like we used to. You know, because just like I'm saying, everything was easy 23 years ago, but you know, but we're not the same individuals now.
No. Nope.
So, you know, at the end of the day, you know, life is good.
Life is good.
You know, I wake up in the morning with a smile on my face and just know that I woke up.
Yeah.
You
yes,
know?
I know.
And that, yeah, and that's the total blessing of life now, you know, and just, I'm telling you about, you just got to seize it and make it amazing.
Yeah.
You know, and with you know, we have opportunities, like I said, to be a part of your show, and is helping other individuals. It's so important, not even just for me, it helps me so much.
Well, this platform, you know, is an incredible platform to,
yes,
be able,
absolutely,
and not only for the people that are watching us now, but, you know, when I upload it to Facebook, to YouTube, and put it on a website, you know, someone that needs to hear something could listen to it a million times. You know,
yes,
if we can inspire somebody, that we're doing our job. We're
absolutely
doing our job through our story. I don't mean to cut you off.
Yeah.
You and I could talk forever and ever.
Absolutely.
But there is another partner of yours who we,
yes,
want to chat a little bit with, and she's probably, you know, oh, I know your wife. She's probably like taking notes about commenting on every single thing we were talking about because she's so dynamic and she has so much information to share.
You know, she loves organizing her, her life plan. Yeah, so you know, she's you know, she's a total writer, so she's writing right now.
So I'm gonna you know what though?
Yeah.
I'm gonna let you do the honor and introduce your wife because you know her better than anybody.
Yeah.
So I'm gonna let you do the honor of introducing your wife and tell us who she is and, you know, run down my promo without even have to look at it. But, you know, give us what you think her gifts are.
Okay.
And just don't take 20 years, because I know we have to. She's worth 20 years away.
she is the most dynamic woman ever, you know, and she, not even just being my wife, she's my best friend. She's my partner, my mate, my everything, you know. She is, she's not just the my, how can I say it? She's not just Dana. She is a person who's very caring.
Yeah.
You know, we can just I can just have a lot of information. She's full of information and knowledge.
Wisdom.
You know, to be who she is, and she is, like I said, if I could say one word about her, a caring individual who loves the Lord, you know, and gives God all the glory of everything what she does in life, you know. It is so much, Renee. She amazes me every day.
She does. She amazes me as well.
You know, and what she does for our family, you know, that I can just say that I really, you know, she's the love of my life. You know, that I know that where would I be without her? You know, I can see her and I'm about to probably tear up because I care. She cares about me.
Yeah.
You know, it's a blessing that she really chose me as her husband.
Can you believe that, though? Doesn't that amaze you that of all the people in the entire universe, you were the one?
Yeah.
You were the one.
And she chose me, you know, and I just know what God has, you know, brought us together, and I know he brought us together for a reason, you know.
God loves you so much that he brought a wonderful angel into your life.
And that's the key word, angel, you know.
I can't hear you.
In the world. And she's so multifaceted on so many things, Renee. This girl never,
I can't hear you. Uh-oh.
Can you hear me now?
Yes.
Okay. My little trainer pushed something here.
Oh, that's okay.
So, I'm gonna let you talk with her because,
we're blessed.
I'm just, like I said, I'm tearing up now.
Aw.
But I just love my wife.
Well, we all love her too. We love you too.
Yeah, so, and,
aww.
And I love my family.
Yeah, aren't we blessed?
Yes. So, I want to introduce my wife. Okay. Thank you. Okay. All right. You ready? All right.
Hi, Dana. Hi. How are you?
I'm wonderful. How are you?
I'm good. Thank you. Thank you for joining us and co-hosting with us again.
Definitely. Thank you for having us again.
Oh my gosh, you guys, we got to do this once a month. We do. We have so much to share and so much inspiration, and you know, and you really are an angel to DeMont. He's a strong, but he's gentle, and he really is a good guy, a good spirit.
Definitely. Yes.
So.
Yes.
Tell us how your holidays went. You know, with the family and. You know, and you, because you are the minister at your church?
Yes, this is, I planted one church in 2007, and my dad planted Mount Olive originally in 19. And so to, and then the Lord called me to pastor in 2000.
Wow. You're breaking up. I don't know why you're, can't hear you. I can't hear you. Uh-oh. Oh, that's good. That's good.
Okay.
Okay.
All right. Okay, so then when my dad passed away in 2015, it was just on my heart to continue what he had started. So we just did the name change and kind of incorporated the paperwork with the state. And so we're Mount Olive again, but we decided to add the multicultural community church because we're with the International Council of Community Churches, wow, as well as American Baptist Churches USA.
Wow, that's incredible. Yeah. That's incredible. Yeah. And how long is your father in the church? How long did he minister?
Wow, my dad pastored from 1988 to around 2007, just before 2007. And then I founded Mount Calvary in 2007. And so he was my pastor growing up, and then I became his pastor.
Wow.
After that. So it was definitely a different relationship. Not just with my dad, but my mom as well, because my mom was my Sunday school teacher, my first Sunday school teacher. Strictly because I wouldn't stay in class. I wouldn't do anything without my mom, so I wouldn't sit in the Sunday school class without her. And so she said, okay, well, I better start teaching. And so that's what she did. She started teaching the class, and then years later, again, I became her pastor as well. So it's been a different kind of relationship.
Wow. So, yeah. you know, people ask me, like, about my relationship with God and about my relationship and my faith in Jesus and the Holy Spirit and all that. And the truth is that it's so a part of my culture and a part of who I am that
right.
It's not a separation. Like I don't need to think about it. It is who I am.
It just is. Exactly. Exactly. That's how I am as well. I don't know life outside of church. My mom initially was Lutheran, and so I spent the first few years of my life in a Lutheran church, and then I went to Roman Catholic schools from second grade to 12th grade. And my dad was Baptist, and so I went through Catholic church and Catholic school, and then also had experience in the Baptist church, and then exposed to many other different denominations. But all in all, I don't remember, I never had, it's not a matter of not even remembering, I never had life outside of the church.
Yes.
And it was never just sitting around in church either. From the very beginning, we had to be active, and so my first role in the church was in Sunshine Choir in nursery school. And then I think I've held just about every position in church with the exception of a deacon, because traditionally the deacons were males. But I stood in for deacons that were, you know, absent on that day or
wow.
You know, whatever the case may be. But I was choir director, church secretary. I taught Sunday school at each level, taught Bible study. I've been a minister licensed for 16 years
wow.
And ordained for 15 years. And so I, my spiritual life, like you said, is as much part of me as my skin.
Right.
There is no separation. And then the most intimate time for me is worship. When I'm in worship, that is the most intimate time. And I've been so blessed when I think about my relationship with my dad and with my mom, but my dad in particular, because we had a different kind of worship, just on a different level. And there were some days that in the very beginning of the church, there were only two of us, my dad and myself, in church. And we would just worship and sing together and praise God together. And so I'm daddy's girl for life. I'm a daddy's girl for life. My daddy loved me. Oh, I just can't even, there are no words for it. But, so we had great memories, you know, just my whole life. But my greatest memories are worshiping and praying with my dad. And seeing the results of those things. You know, when you can pray for someone and then you can see God answer that prayer and you know that that's something that you did together, absolutely amazing, an amazing feeling. And that all came from his mom, my grandma. My greatest memories with her is praying and worshiping and having devotion every single morning. You couldn't be at her house. She's in Coriopolis, Pennsylvania, just outside of Pittsburgh.
Wow.
You could not be at her home without having devotion every morning. We had the same songs, we had Bible study, and we had prayer every single morning. That was just the way it was. And as a little girl, you know, and all of us, my cousins and that, you kind of want to get out and play and do this and do that. But when you get older, you appreciate that she made us sit down and have that.
Because
really, she taught us how to pray and to pray fervently and pray in the spirit and call in the Lord by his characteristic when we need him. You know, when we need a healing, you know, that we call him Yahweh Rapha, that's his name in the word, and Yahweh Nisi, and our victory or our banner. You know, whatever it is that we need, she taught us all of those things. So I just had so much spiritual education, Christian education, and a true foundation in education in love. You know, God is love, and it taught me how to love people.
Yes.
And so I can't separate it just like you. And don't want to.
No. But it's not even like it's a question. It's just who we are. We carry it with us. This is not making us any different than anybody else, but we have it within us. So we represent our faith, walking the walk. And
that's right.
Like Damon and I were talking before, it's really hard to do the right thing all the time when the world is going in the wrong direction, you know? So it's really hard. So how do you, you know, I know you've met Damon, and how do you feel, and I know the answer for myself, but tell us how you would express to everyone how important it is to have faith, and it doesn't matter what dimension, even though we have strong faith in our dimension, but just to hold on to when you're suffering from plan B.
I've always seen, I believe I may have touched on this on the last show that we were on. I always say that most of what we go through is not for us. It's for someone else. And it took me to have an auto accident. I'm not sure if I shared that with you.
You did, but share it to us again. Share it with us again.
Okay, in 2009, I was in an auto accident, and everything changed. At that point, I'd already left corporate America. I had been a high school teacher at that point for 10 years and had the accident. And it took me out of the classroom, had to go through a number of different therapies in that, and they told me I could not teach anymore. That was just the bottom line. And I had degrees in other areas and that, but, you know, you get into a space where you know who you are without any training, without any, you know, formal college training or anything. I'm an educator. That's what God made me be. And I appreciate him for that. And so when I was in the classroom, I had really found my call. You know, I knew that was where I was supposed to be. I had a number of administrators come to me asking me to go into administration and, you know, how I could be promoted to this and end up at the administrative offices and that. But that's not where God called me to be. He called me to be in the classroom with my students, who I love as much today as I did back then. And many of them I'm still in contact with. And I mean regular contact, not just, you know, once every blue moon, just all the time. My kids, many of them call me mom. And so that was the relationship that I had. And so to be taken out of the classroom away from them was really heart-wrenching, because it wasn't a decision that I had made at that time. I knew that God was moving me out of the classroom into something else, but I didn't know when, I didn't know how, and I didn't know that it was going to be that soon. And so, but he knows best, and so I did not bemoan that, but I didn't know what I was going to do next, you know, with my life. And he had already, the Lord had already placed it on my heart to start a nonprofit to support our veterans, and I had already done that the year prior. I had finished the education, all the education that I wanted to finish, so that wasn't an issue. But my plan B at that point was trying to get back what I had lost. The doctors told me that I would not have the IQ that I had before, and I wouldn't do this, and I wouldn't do that. And I was just sharing this with the mom, and my mom yesterday that I went to Borders bookstore when they were still open, and I went over to the second grade sections and got a lot of different workbooks and matching pictures and finding the differences in pictures and elementary level crossword puzzles, and I worked at it every single day. There I was, I had two doctorate degrees and I couldn't do simple math. And I was very, very upset and despondent just with life, not with God.
Right.
Because I knew
right.
He was doing something, but I didn't understand what it was.
Because we don't see it. We don't see the work He's doing. We just
right.
have, that's where our faith comes in, and we have to
that's
trust
that right.
He is doing it, but we have to just have patience.
Exactly. And so, to make a long story short, through all of that, I understood the concept of winter. It's a season that we're approaching now. Many of us who are in the areas with snow, some people who, you know, we have a little envy of,
California.
no, I say that.
I know. Just
believe we're not envious, but, you know, we have the snow and the cold sometimes. And so when we have that and we see the winter and we see the snow, we've already seen all of the leaves fall off the trees and then we see dry branches and empty branches. But we know that spring is coming. So when we see all of the snow and we see things that look to be dead, we have to keep in mind that everything is still fresh and new underneath that snow. We can't see it. We can't see the snow under the snow. We can't see under that level of frozen dirt or that layer of frozen dirt. But we have to know in our rational mind that there are seedlings that are still working. There's a lot still going on because once spring hits, we begin to see those flowers. We begin to see we begin to see the new foliage and all of these things that are coming along. But we know that that was happening in those winter months.
And it's true that sometimes you have to... you know, you have to shed a lot of the old and things that are not good for you anymore. And
right.
And we don't do that. We don't do that ourselves. So So nature and God has to reproduce for us ourselves.
Exactly. And so we have to understand that when we go through things in life, when I had the accident, when my husband suffered the stroke, when you suffered the stroke, there are other things that, you know, people go through. Those are wintertime situations. Those are just winter situations.
Right.
And we have to see that as the snow, that layer of snow. But God is still moving underneath, and the springtime is coming very, very soon, and we just need to hold on. And we have to know that, again, it's not all for us. It's not something that happened to us or to punish us or, you know, why did God let this happen? God allows things because He wants better for us, and He already has a plan for us. And so when this is all we can see, we have to know that, number one, a blessing is coming for us, and number two, that it's to help somebody else to get through what they're going to inevitably go through as long as life continues.
Right.
We also have to understand that we need to praise God. There's not a day, besides the accident, I now have fibromyalgia and some other issues that are still the damage to the scapula and all of these things that cause a lot of pain in my body.
Right.
And so it's easy sometimes for people to say you have to embrace the pain, but you do. What I found was that I started praising God that I feel the pain, because if I had died in that auto accident, or if my husband died with that stroke, or you died when you had that stroke, we wouldn't feel pain. We wouldn't have anything that we wouldn't have any, well, some people have strong disabilities in that, but we could have the alternative.
Right.
And the alternative is no longer being here. And so that's how you can embrace the pain. Say, what is the other option? And the other option is death. The other option is not being around our families anymore. The other option for you is I can't see and hear Blakey, you know, with his big smile and those cheeks that I absolutely adore.
He's funny. He's funny.
Right. And Trinity, and you know, we can't enjoy life and we can't help others enjoy it. When people see us smile through our pain, they can know that they can do the same thing. God's not a respecter of persons.
Yeah.
What He'll do for one, He'll do for another.
I believe that.
So we have to do that example. And it's not being phony, and it's not being fake, and it's not just keeping a stiff upper lip and act like everything's okay. We have to embrace what we go through, and everything needs to be okay. Amen?
Yes, yes, amen. And that's true, because, you know, most people, you know, I'm always reading inspiring books or listening to the Dale Carnegie or whatever it is, I'm always listening to it. And, you know, sometimes people just they're not making stories out for themselves, but what they're doing is they're preparing their path. And
right.
They're talking about, yes, I will be on Good Morning America, like I always
right.
say. And yes,
right.
I will be on Kelly and Ryan. Yes, I will be. And, you know, when they call me, it's not that I am lying about it. I'm trying to manifest it. I want it. And you need to talk about things already being happened, because.
Yes.
Right? So talk about that a little
bit. That's right. Well, the power of life and death is in the tongue. That's what the word says. And so if we speak doom and gloom, that's what we're manifesting into our lives.
Right, right.
This is where, you know, you get all of these little fads that people jump on, The Secret and this and that. And some new fad that you know, they can work through this and work through that workbook and this. Well, it's been in the Bible for the longest. And, you know, most of the times that's free. You know, you can just grab that word and it's free. You don't have to jump on the new fad train, you know, whatever that is. It's just speaking it into existence. Amen. The word of God says what's loosed in heaven is loosed on earth. And the opposite, what's loosed on earth is loosed in heaven. So God has already done everything that he's going to do for us. But we have to be ready to receive it. There are things that are just out there waiting for us to reach out and grab it.
And to believe it
in our heart.
Right, and to believe that we are worthy of it. Because I've always, you know, I don't know whether it's my stroke or my upbringing or, you know, the things that you're taught when you're young, be happy, you know, you don't need this, you don't need that.
Right.
You know, and it's not their fault for teaching us. That's what they knew. But
Right. But
we have to know that we're worthy for whatever God brings us, whatever
That's
God
right.
brings us.
Absolutely. We're in a different dispensation now. When I think about, like, our ancestors were in the fields, and they were enslaved at the beginning of their arrival in this country. For the most part, there are many who were already here, but those that were enslaved and captured, there were songs that were sung, Go Down Moses, Swing Low, Sweet Chariot, I Wonder When the Lighthouse Will Shine on Me. All of those were songs that allowed them to survive, you know, a situation that they knew was dismal, and they knew that they would not see freedom, and that maybe the generation behind them or the generation behind them would not see freedom. So there were things that were taught in that situation, in that time period, in order to allow themselves and their descendants to survive. It was about survival. We can't say those same things. I sing those songs right now and appreciate what my antecedents went through.
Right.
I appreciate all the prayers that went forth, but I'm not in a field, and I don't have to wonder when the lighthouse is going to shine on me. I have to know that the lighthouse has shone, and I need to be there basking in the light now, not only for myself and for my family, but for those same antecedents, because we have to make sure that the life we live ensures that the life they lived was not in vain. And that's not just with my ancestors, all of us, I don't care what nationality, you know, we're a part of, we all come from some different kind of situations and different kinds of backgrounds, particularly
right.
being in this country. Many of our ancestors came for a better life, so they didn't have great lives. And then when they got here, they didn't have great lives. There was work involved and blood, sweat, and tears involved. And so we owe it to all of them to live our best lives so that what they've worked for has come to fruition.
Right.
So we have to embrace and get through all of those things that are going to happen, and then we have to make sure that we are calling forth those things, not only for ourselves, like you said, speaking those things into existence, but we also have to say that I am going to receive everything that my ancestors did not receive. Everything that they were supposed to receive and that the enemy stopped them from receiving, or some decisions that they may have made stopped them from receiving, I am going to receive that now in the name of Jesus, and I'm going to make sure that my descendants make use of that as well, because I God, be obedient then to the Lord and ask Him how to use it.
Yep, and we amen. And we pass it on to our children and the next generations.
That's right.
That's what we're setting it up for.
Yeah.
So I was on Facebook and we were talking about this before. You are now teaching VIP kids. Tell us a little bit about that and how the world, how God is using your teachings in a modern way. So tell us a little bit about that.
VIP Kid is a company based out of Beijing, China, and they are set up to allow teachers who are native English speakers with either an American background or Canadian. So there's I hesitate to say this, I don't want to be offensive, but a minimal accent, if that would make sense.
Yeah, because they got to be able to clearly understand
exactly.
And hear what it is, because they're hearing it. God, could you imagine? Well, when they speak Chinese to us, we don't understand it.
We don't understand all of it, exactly.
Right.
Exactly. And so they need to hear it as clean as possible.
Yes.
That's the best way to say it.
Yes, as pure as possible.
Right, exactly. And so the opportunity opened up. Again, going back to when the doctors told me that I could not teach anymore, the Lord has now allowed me to teach in church again and now this way. So this is also a plan B. Right. I can teach. There's some T-shirts that are out there from VIP Kid, and they say I travel to Beijing every morning.
That's awesome.
Right. It's a way to teach children English and allow them to live their best lives also. Because the reality is that in different countries, if they can be more international, so to speak, they're going to advance more in their lives. And so these are small children from the ages of 3 to about 10, 11 that are learning the English language. And we're able to, just like we're doing now, it's a Skype-type platform.
My God, to connect with them, when you see their eyes, it must be so humbling and very empowering.
Right, and that speaks to what you were just saying about what our generations before us taught us. They were trying to teach humility, right?
Right.
That just kind of jumped out at me when you said that. But yeah, it is, because you're being used to teach other people who may not have access otherwise. You know, how many children are able to come to the United States or go to Canada and speak with a native speaker? And
right.
So through VIP Kit, they're able to do this, and also able, on the other end, teachers who need supplemental income or those who are retired and just miss the classroom. I miss being in the classroom. I miss being with my kids. I had one student when I posted that I was a VIP Kit teacher now. She has 3 children, and
oh
she
God.
Says, where are you teaching? Tell me. My kids will be in class with you tomorrow. Online. But it provides an opportunity for other children as well as educators to connect in a different way. As well, there are many teachers who go over to different countries, but everybody is not afforded that opportunity. So this is also a way to be able to teach, they call it ESL, English as a Second Language. To teach ESL in different areas to other students. And I hope that they open it up to different countries, because that would just be fun to have other organizations in other countries, Mexico and Italy and just other countries where you can connect. The internet is being used positively.
Yes.
You know, we see so many heinous things.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Yes. I was going to ask you, if I'm speaking Chinese and I'm young and I'm on the other end, I guess their parents are with them when they connect?
Many of them are sitting in the room with them, but some of them with the older students, they said that they keep them outside of the room. But we use what's called TPL, and Jamont is laughing at me when I'm really getting this down to a science now. But if you're using your whole body, I'm sorry, TPR, I said TPL, to use your body to respond and to tell a story and to speak, because they don't understand. So you're doing a lot of, if I ask them to say something and I want them to repeat it, I can't just say repeat. That means nothing.
Right,
so
right,
I can,
right.
Right, so I'm doing this to make sure to let them. for doing this to say do it again.
Is that and is that something that has been taught to you, or something that is just like kind of a way to speak to each other?
No, it was issued through VIP Kit, and in the last couple of weeks now, I've done some independent studying on it, and I understand now that it was introduced actually by a gentleman, a doctor, back in 1969, and it was to teach children of foreign languages, of other languages, how to speak and how to respond, and they started doing it with storytelling. There are groups that would tell, they would be in circles, and it seemed like it was almost like an improv group. And they would have to tell stories using their hands and using their body and using facial expressions to be able to teach other students. And so it is caught on around the world now, just around the globe. And so I'm studying it more and more.
That reminds me of when my father first broke his ankle and went into the hospital. That evening after his surgery, he had distress. And he couldn't, they had to put a tube down him. And so that began a 2-week journey. And actually, I had written a quote about it, like a chapter about it, but I don't know what I did with it. But one of the parts in the chapter was that there was this Chinese family in the waiting room. Like we lived in the waiting room now. Now the waiting room, you know, you can only let two people in the room with your family members at a time. So we all stationed ourselves. We all slept in the waiting room, you know, and I actually brought an angel in there, and I had it on the windowsill. And every time they would pass it, they would bow to it because they really found reverence, and they were just looking, and actually their daughter was passing away. Their daughter was not going to make it. So, you know, just to be in that world, and I'm telling you, and it's so humbling, the ICU womb. Like, that was my title to it, ICU, like the life in ICU. It's a whole, you don't even know what's going on outside. You don't even care what's going on outside.
No, exactly.
The only thing you care about is that moment and your family member that's in there. And so, you know, then my father, you know, their daughter hadn't passed yet, and my father got moved, and he got, you know, up, and this was the beginning of our journey with my father.
Okay.
But he went into another room, so when I went, we were cleaning out the room, and I went back, I actually gave the angel to the guy. So we were communicating without even being able to understand each other, and hugging each other, and really be supporting each other. And it was really a moment in time for me, now that I'm thinking about it, really,
certainly,
you know, such an astounding moment. And then we found out that his daughter passed away.
Passed on.
But just the moment, the speaking to each other without being able to,
non-verbal
communication, very powerful.
Right. Yes, it certainly is. I mean, it's very interesting. I told him, I think this was yesterday, I was looking at a video of another teacher for VIP Kid, and she was just kind of giving an assessment of where she was. And she's also in a brick and mortar school right now. And so she teaches VIP Kid in the early morning hours because, you know, there's that 11 to 12 hour time change. And so when they're asleep, we're up, and vice versa. So the schedule is with early morning, which is great for parents of little ones and that, because while they're still asleep and you can be asleep, you can be working.
Right.
But for teachers who have to be in the classroom, they do it in the morning and then they go to the classroom. So this teacher is saying she taught middle school and high school, and she finds herself mimicking and doing these things to the big kids, and they're laughing at her. But they're also paying more attention, though, because they see her making these grand gestures, and they don't understand why. And it's because she's practicing CPR.
Wow.
Yeah.
So, you know, another thing that I heard through you when we were talking before was now you've been honored in the American Human Rights Council. Tell us a little bit about that.
Yes, that is a huge honor for me. There's a gentleman that I've been connected with now for about 7 years. His name is Ahmad Hamad, and he is the founder and executive director of the American Human Rights Council. He used to be the director at the, I'm going to get this right, the Arab American Anti-Discrimination Committee, which is a big deal here in Michigan because we have in Dearborn, which is probably about 20 minutes from us, that's the largest population of Arab Americans, really the largest populated area in the country.
Wow.
And so we have a very good relationship. You know, we had some other groups that were coming in trying to cause tension and dissension, and thank God it didn't work. But there's a very highly concentrated community in Dearborn. And so I was asked to be a part of that group. And it was that was such an honor when Imad headed that, because I was number one of two Christians on the committee and the only African American on the committee. And so it was a way to really integrate and
yes.
to stand up for people who at that time after 9/11, number one, didn't have a voice, and number two, were in a very similar situation that I have been in and you know, my community is in on a daily basis and historically has been in. So it was a way to connect and to help someone else get through. There again, a lot of things that we go through are not for us, but someone else,
right?
Right. Because now if you're able to identify with another group who's being ostracized since 9/11.
Wow.
And so I was on that committee and the accident happened. And so once that accident happened, everything changed and I kind of sat down for a while and Imad stepped in and he helped with Calvary House, which is the nonprofit for our veterans.
Right, right.
Well, now he left there and there was a lot of transition and he widened his circle to help anyone all over the world who is having any kind of difficulty. That's from immigrants who have made it here, those who are not being allowed to come over, those who are political prisoners, those people who are tortured for the sake of their religion. Doesn't matter if it's Christian, Muslim, it makes no difference. He is a true humanitarian and believes in people and has a love for people. And so to be asked to sit on the board of directors for that organization is a huge honor for me because it allows me to be able to really get more of a backstage of what's going on around the world. He's got more inside information because he talks to those victims and their families.
Mm-hmm.
He talks to people who are being imprisoned and tortured on a daily basis for many different reasons. And so to be able to sit on that committee and really not just help them the way he wants to help, wants us to help them, but to be able to see what God wants me to do, you know, as that tenure may end.
Right, right. So, you know, I don't know if we could ever make it work, but I would love to have him as a guest on the show.
That would be great. I'll connect with him today and
yeah.
get you guys connected.
Yeah.
That
yeah. I don't know if he can come over to your house. I mean, you know, you guys should be on it together.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Whatever
yeah,
way.
Yeah.
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 We can work.
Yeah.
Out.
That would
definitely.
Be awesome. You know, I
okay.
think it's all really important to connect and just keep the voice out and the communication. And you know, it's so funny, Dana, because once again. You know, I live in my own bubble. I do. I've always lived in my own bubble.
Uh-huh.
I walk to the beat of a different drummer. I absolutely,
right.
positively know that. You know,
yep.
To me, I was raised in my father's deli. Okay?
Okay.
My father's deli had all sorts of people coming through.
Okay.
So
uh-huh.
as I was raised, I never saw any difference in color or religion.
Right.
I never. So when I hear the things that happen, I just say, why? Like, I just, it doesn't, and to me, there is no reason for it. You can't sit there and tell me that there's a reason for being disrespectful and hurting somebody. There's
right.
just no reason for it. There's no
right.
reason. So it's
I think it's conscious ignorance and embrace fear is what it is. You know,
yeah.
people are afraid of what they don't know. And they're afraid to get to know it. And so that's why I say conscious ignorance, because that at that point you choose to remain in a state of ignorance. You choose to not know people. You choose to not embrace other cultures. When you open your eyes and your heart to other cultures, you have opened yourself up to so many different worlds. And the beauty in it is there are no words for the beauty in that. When you go and you see Asian parades and the dances and the
yes.
costuming. You do the same with the Caribbean costumes. I did that for a while. There's another gentleman you may want to speak to that's a friend of mine. He is the only person who does true Caribbean costuming in the state of Michigan. He's from Trinidad, and he's been here, I want to say, since the either late 60s or the early 70s. But his company is called Caribbean Mardi Gras Productions.
Wow.
And so I used to do the parades with him, and just to put on the big,
festive
pet dresses and all of the fashion, and he would make these himself.
Wow.
But that's another culture that you're embracing.
Culture
and then
so
you begin to realize, you begin to realize when you open yourself up to other cultures, you begin to connect to who you are.
Yeah.
Because you start seeing in other cultures, oh my gosh, that looks like my cousin. Oh my Lord, that looks like my aunt or my uncle. And then you start researching and realizing, yeah, that's who I am. I've got a little bit of that in me.
You know, it really upsets me when I watch the news and the advertisements and the radios and, you know, the commercials and stuff, and that they describe somebody as to their color or faith. When the truth is, I'm going to talk about Catholics. There's wonderful Catholics in the world, but there's also vicious Catholics in the world.
You're so
you know, when we do something wrong, you don't talk about that Catholic killed somebody. They don't do that. You know, but when somebody of your color, black, they go, oh, that black person. I'm like, I don't get that. That's unfair. It's unjust. So that just, that really just, because I was raised, my father, I was blessed to be raised in my father's deli, where I interacted with every culture and every single person, and they treated me like family. They loved me. You know, I was on a milk crate making potato salad while they were hanging out, you know, while they were hanging out there, and you know, so.
Right. Well, you know what's funny? I told you my dad's family's all from Coriopolis, Pennsylvania, and that was a primarily Italian town. And so my grandpa, when he spoke, he would always, and I can hear him right now, and it's so endearing. Every time we got off the phone, he'd say, "All right, baby, you be sweet now." That's he spoke.
Yeah.
You know, that's the way he spoke.
Yeah.
Those friends were, and we're talking about now. My grandpa was born in 1915. And he, now outside of Coriopolis, there was a lot that he went through because he was, he worked directly for Mr. Rockwell of Rockwell International, and he initially was a driver and drove him all around the country, but then he became the first African-American manager at Rockwell. Mr. Rockwell just kept him on, and he was the first African-American manager. And so outside of Coriopolis, he faced a lot of discrimination. But inside of Coriopolis, it didn't matter what color, it didn't matter what creed, everybody, I mean, the whole town was probably the size of our house, but I joke, but it was probably about maybe 1,200 people.
Yeah.
And you knew everybody. I could walk down the street and go to, you know, any place in the city, and somebody was looking after me. Oh, you're Timor's girl. You're, you know. And they knew who we were, but everyone loved everyone, genuinely, and not just on the surface. This was for generations. And so my dad got pretty hard hit because he moved to Washington, D.C. at one point. And it, as a young African-American male in the 60s in Washington, D.C., he didn't understand what was going on. You know, he went to buy a movie ticket, and they told him he had to go to the back door into the balcony. And he threw the ticket back at him and said, "I'm not going anywhere," because this is not the way he grew up.
No.
It just wasn't the way he was raised.
And it's not fair. It's not.
So I think there are pockets in the country that are disgustingly racist, and there are more good people. But the disgusting racist people get the spotlight.
You know what, Dana? Inside, our souls, our love, we're all alike. We're all alike. These are just the shells that as earth.
But Ed said they're earth suits. That's what he always called them. They're just earth suits.
Yeah.
But you have to want to get to know someone, and you have to stop believing heinous propaganda is what it is. You just have to stop believing that and get to know someone yourself. And then we have to teach our children. I think, you know, even people in our generation and generations behind us don't consciously sometimes make an effort to inundate their children with multiculturalism, and that is so important. When I get Trinity's books, I make sure, like on her bookshelf, there, just yesterday, I bought some books about Kwanzaa, I bought books about Chinese New Year, I bought books about the Hebrew culture. She has books about East Indian, Native American. She's got books about everybody back there. Some I hadn't even heard of. She's got some Yiddish books back there,
that's,
you know,
good,
about different cultures. You cannot get your child, they can't get her all black dolls.
No.
She's got black dolls back there.
She's got to know that the toys are the same as reality, you know.
You've got to inundate them with that, because what they see initially is what is going to be at the forefront of their minds. And so if you live in an area that's primarily one race and one nationality, you got to expose them to other things. Don't just let a child stay in a bubble.
Yeah, I was blessed.
And I was too.
Yeah.
I went to St. Michael's School, and we were, Dubai and I are from Southfield, Michigan, originally, and which we always laugh about because we were really across one main street from each other and never met. But crazy. But in my school, we were all mixed up. You know, we had so many different nationalities, and we're still friends now. And I always say we're not just friends, we are family, and we're going to always be family. It didn't matter what color, you know, we were, and we did have exposure to different foods and different music, and you know, we just had exposure to all of that. And so I was never impacted until I got to high school. When I got to high school, that's when it got ugly for me, and that's when I started seeing the ugliness in the world that my parents wanted to shelter me from. And it was hurtful, and a lot of it, you know, like you talked about some of the Roman Catholics, it was some of, well, the main culprit were the nuns, really, you know. But then I had a couple of nuns that, two of them, Sister Teresa was one, and then Sister Maria, my heart, she will always be my heart. Better for everybody else. So you have to take people for who they are, and
even the sisters and the priests and the ministers and the pastors. There's good ones and there's bad ones.
Right.
They're all people.
People, but all fallible. All of us.
Yeah.
Only infallible is Christ.
So since you're on the book topic, I cannot believe you are publishing your 20th book. Tell us.
Fourteenth.
Tell us about your.
Yes, but right now we're on the 14th, and that one, yes. So the this one is about marketing. It's about the marketing function in the United States in the 20th century. So it's kind of a leap pad to show where we were and how we got to this social media marketing, because you can't market without knowing social media at this point. But I'm talking about the grassroots of all of it. When there was, you know, we had to really put in some elbow grease to go out there and market. Some of the young marketers, I think they would probably stop the industry. They would not be involved in that area if they had to sit there and do a direct mail package, you know, doing snail mail and putting stamps on 200, 300, 1,000 envelopes. That's the way you had to do it. And so I'm talking about the grassroots foundation of the marketing function in the United States and the impact it had on consumers in the United States. And this was actually my dissertation for my first PhD. I'm back a little bit, but keeping the bulk of what was there and reproducing it as a as an informational book as to a dissertation.
What I would like to do is one day, because our first video didn't come out, our first interview didn't come out too well, but our next interview, have your books so that we could talk about each one, and we could really, you know, show your trail of experience. And, you know, and God is telling me right now to ask you to write a book about being a caretaker, being how it feels from your perspective to support your husband, and to what the keys are that really needs to do that. I'm writing three books. One is From the Inside of an Aphasic Mind, how it feels, how it feels to suffer from aphasia, you know,
right.
and the awareness that it takes for me to always remember how it was to feel that way, so that I can have the compassion for
right.
those, and what it takes to recover from it, what
right.
recovers from it. And I know love and God is a huge part of that as well. And,
it is.
And then the other one is Extra Innings, it's called. It's really my bio. It's about living, because I was an avid softball player. And,
okay.
And my stroke and my concussion, getting hit in the head, that happened on a softball field. So it's about,
oh,
I'm in the extra inning. What are you going to do about it?
Right.
What are you going
right.
to do about it? What are you going to do
right.
with that extra inning? You're going to win,
uh-huh.
you're going to lose, you know? And then
yeah.
the third one is my Awaken Your Practice. It's about living your life. So, yeah, so one day I would love
yeah.
For you to put your books up and talk about it. I know you did it last time, but just so that we could, you know,
sure.
revisit them and make sure we have documentation of it.
That'd be great. That would be great.
So I think we've been on for an hour, almost 2 hours. We're working on the 2 hours.
Oh, my goodness. Okay.
I know, we could talk forever, all of us. Is DeMont close?
Yep, he's right here.
So we're gonna end with a little prayer, if you don't mind.
Okay. Just come in. Do you want to do a prayer? Pray,
because that's how we always end our end beginning.
Hi, DeMont.
He said
hi. She said hi to you. Okay. All right, so we'll close out. Father, we come to you and we thank you, we praise you, we take joy in you and everything that you've given us, all that you are for us, Lord God. We thank you today, Heavenly Father, that, and I'm just hearing again, like we talked about, embracing the pain. We thank you that we can embrace the pain, Lord God, because, Father, when you embrace your pain, Heavenly Father, everything that you endured before the cross and everything you endured on the cross, Lord, when you embraced your pain, you embraced it, Lord God, because you knew that your pain, Heavenly Father, your suffering, Lord God, was there to give us a chance at eternal life. Heavenly Father, we can never do what you did, Heavenly Father. We can never endure what you endured, Heavenly Father. But Lord, if we just embrace our pain so that we can help someone else overcome, that's the best that we can do, and we will give you all the praise and all the honor and all the glory. We thank you that Renee is embracing her pain by allowing this show to provide an avenue for others, Heavenly Father, all over, Lord God. We may just have a few viewers at a time, but Lord, we know that these shows on the internet go worldwide, Heavenly Father. So we thank you that her way of embracing the pain, Heavenly Father, is it by providing an avenue for others who have suffered, Lord Jesus Christ, to find a way to embrace their change, Heavenly Father, and to step into their next place on their journey, to step into their healing space, and to step into their purpose, Lord God. We thank you, Lord Jesus Christ, that because Brother DeMont is embracing his pain, Heavenly Father, he's able to help others with the American Heart Association, with those who are impacted by the American Stroke Association, and with those, Heavenly Father, who are impacted by Survivor Network, Lord God. We thank you, Lord Jesus, that I have embraced my pain, Lord God. I'm able now, Father God, to teach kids in China, Heavenly Father, to be able to reach out to those who may be questioning their faith, who have hard questions about Christianity that other people may not want to answer, Lord God, that I can talk to them and I can teach, Lord God. And that way I'm embracing my pain, Heavenly Father, and staying along a course of purpose. We thank you, Lord God, for each of these avenues you've given us, and we thank you that you've allowed these avenues to cross, Lord God, that no longer is there a fork in the road, Heavenly Father, to decide whether someone's going to give up or not. But there's a fork in the road to say either I'm going to survive this way or that way. I'm going to walk this road to victory or that road to victory. But in the end, I will win no matter what. And thank you, Lord Jesus, that you allow us to have victory. That when we turn to the back of the book, Lord God, we win, Heavenly Father. We win. And so we embrace that pain right now because the pain leads us to victory, Lord God. We thank you and praise you that we are all here. All those that are watching, all those that have tuned in the past, those that have been co-hosts on the show, Lord God. We have all tuned into your victory, Lord Jesus, tapped into your victory, Lord God. And we cannot lose, Heavenly Father. We cannot lose, Lord God. We have embraced our pain, Lord Jesus Christ, and we are here, Heavenly Father, speaking about it, giving testimonies about it, because the alternative, Father God, would be death, Lord. But we are here living in this avenue, in this plane, Lord God, on this earth, and we are living until we have that opportunity to step into that eternal life that you have guaranteed us through Christ Jesus. We thank you, Lord God, for this day and every preceding day, because these days, Heavenly Father, will be our best. You said, Father God, in your word, and it is written that our latter days will be greater than the past. So we walk into our latter days right now. We walk into the future right now. We know, Lord God, that we cannot go forward, Heavenly Father, looking in a rearview mirror. So, Lord, we go forward right now with you in the name of Jesus. We look forward, Heavenly Father, keeping our eyes on the prize, Lord God, keeping our eyes forward and determined to cross that finish line that leads to you. We thank you and praise you in the name of Jesus for this and all things. And we say together, amen, 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 and amen.
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 Amen. Yay. Yes. Thank you so much. You're both such a blessing. You're such just a blessing. So tell them out. We're going to blow our kisses now in 1 second. But I want to thank everybody for joining us today. Damont and Dana are really a gift. And the channel that we have on Facebook, the platform, is always a gift. Always remember to respect it and use it in the proper fashion, because it is a gift to be able to touch the entire world in 1 split second, and not only at this particular moment, but the ongoing reoccurrences and ongoing hope that we hope to bring to everybody through love is just, it's our way of connecting with you. So we're going to blow our kisses and have a wonderful day, and we're going to do this again probably next month in January. So here we go. Let's blow our kisses. Bye, everyone. Bye.
Bye.
Bye. Bye. Stay there for 1 second.
Okay.